Hi everyone! Welcome back to, I almost said the restricted section. Oh my god. Awesome. Wow, it has been way too long since we filmed, obviously. Welcome back to the Book Brood. We are bringing you our April wrap-up because we suck at life and it's already well into May and we haven't done this yet. So...
And yeah, the Drunken Library was
I know
giving us crap for us teasing them about being behind on tags.
They're on top of their
they
shit.
They got their April wrap-up posted already.
I know. So,
yeah. Honestly. Congratulations, you guys. Yeah, cheers.
I don't even know. Okay, so I read 11 things.
I read 17 things, but that's a lot of stuff with pictures, so. Yeah.
Mine was mostly smut, so it's cool.
Hey, are there any pictures, or?
Not in the smut, no. It is. There are two audiences, male and female. I think that ladies read a lot more smut.
Mm-hmm. That's probably true.
I think it is. Statistically, scientifically.
Scientifically.
Science is proven. I'm going to ask Bill Nye next time I see him.
Should tweet that at him, right?
You start.
Okay. I read Claymore, volumes 13 through 17. This is by Norihiro Yagi. I gave them all 5 stars because I love that series. It is just badass warriors and monsters, big swords.
Yeah.
It's great. I love it. I think I've only got about 4, 5, 6 more volumes in that, so I'm still
before
waiting on volume 18 before it's done.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's an already finished one. So.
Nice. Well, that's nice.
It is nice, yeah.
I mean, it's kind
sort of
sad.
Right.
But it's nice that you don't have to wait for them to come out every 6 months or whatever. The first thing I read was Fish and Chips, which is the third book in the Cut and Run series by Madeline Urban and Abigail Rue. And however many times I say it, I can never remember their names because they're such weird made-up names, obviously. No one wants to put their name on this. Smut. Anyways, this is wonderful.
I don't know why people like it.
I thought I was the only one, but I got so many like comments about people who are like, oh yeah, I remember that series. That's really good. Yay! Anyways, these are getting better and better with each book, which is much preferred than the other way around, like getting worse.
Yeah.
Suck. Because it's a really long series, and I just started the 5th one, and they're just getting better and better and better. Anyways, this was a 4-star read. I think this finally established like what it was trying to do and wasn't focused so much on the explosions and the nursing each other back to health. It actually had some character development, which was appreciated.
They realized at that point that, you know, it was going to be an ongoing series. There,
I think
people,
that's honestly
people keep
what
buying
it was.
This, so we got to take it seriously.
I honestly think it was, yeah.
The next thing I read, I don't have as well, but it's Batgirl Volumes 1 and 2. The New 52 series by Gail Simone. I gave them both 4 stars. I really love Gail Simone's writing, how she writes conversations and characters. I really loved her Birds of Prey run where, you know, Batgirl was Oracle. She's in the wheelchair and everything. So seeing what Gail can do with Batgirl as actually Batgirl is really fun. And so 4 stars, like I said.
The next thing I read was We Should All Be Feminists by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, and this was basically her TED Talks in print format. I thought that it was good, like, people should be experiencing this at some point, but I feel like I have already heard it. Like, I didn't feel like it was a lot of new information. Maybe when it first came out, it was. But glad I read it, but it was underwhelming, and I didn't rate it because it was someone's personal story, and I feel weird rating those.
The next thing I read was Batwoman, Volume 1 and 2 of the New 52 series. This is by J.H. Williams III. I gave these ones 3 stars. They were okay. This is the first Batwoman I've read. An interesting enough character, capable, caper, you know, detective, things like that, but just didn't really hold my interest, so I don't think I'm going to be continuing in that run. So.
Yeah, but you gave it a shot.
I gave it a shot, yeah.
The next thing for me was an audiobook, and this is Two Boys Kissing by David Levithan, and this was narrated by the author, and I think it totally brought the reading experience to a whole nother level, having the author read it. And this is a story about two boys who are trying to beat the world record of, like, the longest kiss. And it ends up being, like, 30-some-odd hours, and it's really long, this whole big process. And the story is narrated by men who died in the AIDS epidemic. And it is a beautiful story. I was listening to it at work, and I, like, had to keep stopping it so, like, I could suck the tears back in, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I completely enjoy this. Highly recommend. I gave it 5 stars.
All right. And then the last thing that I don't have is Red Sonja, Volume 2, The Art of Blood and Fire. This is also by Gail Simone. I read Volume 1 a long time ago, last year sometime. Mm-hmm. I remember liking it a lot more than this one. This one was a lot more silly than the first one, which was a lot more serious, like, you know, her meeting a fellow slave, you know, years in the future, mm-hmm. and being on different sides of a battlefield, things like that. This one was, she was having to gather these people for this pharaoh that was, you know, gonna go to the afterlife in style, you know, with this great party and stuff, so he needed all these people. Anyway, I gave it 3 stars. It was fun enough, but would have liked a little more dark and gritty, I guess.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, I read volumes 1 and 2 of Terraformars. I always mess that up, but it's like spelled like for Mars, like the planet Mars. I'm not just totally flubbing that. Terraformars.
That's really stupid.
Yeah, it is, but... So these are by Yu Sasuga, and this is the weirdest premise ever, but I'm new to manga, and I don't know if this is a normal thing, but this is a story where we have been trying to terraform Mars by sending cockroaches, but over, you know, a century or so, all of the space radiation has made the cockroaches... like, super cockroaches. And so we have to send humans up to, like, wipe them out before we can settle on Mars. But the regular humans just get butchered. And so we have to soup up our humans with more insect DNA so they can fight off the cockroaches.
Right, right. And fire with fire.
Exactly.
Yes.
But they're not all the same insect, so each one has different insect powers. Anyways, I thought the first one was so weird, but so bloody, and it was actually really fascinating because it would go into, like, each insect and their, like, their different powers, I guess.
Yeah.
Abilities.
Mm-hmm.
I gave the first one 5 stars. The second one, I gave 4 stars. I thought the story got really silly. Like, I was... really involved in the, like, action and the gore, and then when the science tried to be all, you know, legit, and it wasn't, and I was just like, no.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't make a lot of sense. Anyways, I did not enjoy the second one nearly as much, and there were way too many boobs for no reason in my manga. It's like,
some of them have that. Yeah.
Not necessary. Like, I like the gore, but just unnecessary nudity wasn't.
Like I'm saying, you gotta read Attack on Titan.
Yeah.
If that's your thing. Yeah. I actually purchased the full run of New 52 Supergirl. This is volumes 1 through 4 that I read in April. I have read volume 5, but it was in May, so I'll talk about that But I gave all of these 4 stars. I really enjoyed this story. It's a much different dynamic than Superman coming to Earth as a baby. This is Kara coming to Earth as a young adult and having memories of Krypton and having a very rough transition to life on Earth and being accepted by Earth and the people there and the other superheroes and things like that. And so I'm really enjoying it, and I'm actually really glad I purchased them.
The art 4 stars. Awesome.
Yeah, very good.
The next thing I read was Iron and Velvet by Alexis Hall, and this is a paranormal investigation story where the main character is an alcoholic, like very self-destructive, super sarcastic, and annoying. So many people don't like her, but she's a badass, and she's like a Jessica Jones character, but like worse, because she's really bad at her job. She just gets lucky a lot of the time. So like she takes a case and then starts sleeping with the client and still trying to solve the case. I thought it was hilarious and it was really enjoyable. And it had a lesbian main character. Well, it had a lot of lesbians in it. Everyone was a lesbian in it. But Kate, the main character, was a lesbian, which I apparently don't read very much of. So it was refreshing.
I don't come across that too often either.
I gave it 4 stars. I enjoyed it, and I will be picking up the sequel.
Actually, that's not true. It's Batwoman. Batwoman's a lesbian.
Really?
So, yeah.
Well, that's cool.
All right, so on to the stuff that... No, I already am on to the stuff that I had. Anyway. The next thing I read in April was The Postman by David Brin. This is the source material for a silly Kevin Costner movie that he tried to adapt in the late 90s. Sucked a lot of the flavor out of this and made it very generic, but it's post-apocalyptic. This focuses more around legends that can take place once communication breaks down, things like that. So it's going around to the main character, the legend he's kind of spreading himself, and then him discovering that other people are spreading their own legends and things like that. But, you know, people are trying to move on. People are trying to form society again, and you know, it doesn't matter if the legend's real or not. And this takes place in our area around here, and so it references, like, specific streets that I know. It's like, I know that place. I went to college there. So I gave it 3 stars because it's not anything new in the age of excess post-apocalyptia, but it was good enough. It was an enjoyable read.
Do you think that the setting that was like around us, and do you think that affected your rating?
Absolutely, yeah.
So if you weren't from Oregon, you don't think that it
would have been? It wouldn't have been as fun.
Nice. Okay, I listened to We Have Always Lived in the Castle by Shirley Jackson, and I feel like we should insert a cover art thing here, because it's a super creepy cover and a creepy concept, and I was expecting this to be a lot scarier than it was. This is a story about some kids who live in this old mansion, and it talks about how a few years ago their parents were murdered and one of them was a suspect but never charged, and everyone in the town just assumes that they did it. And the other kid is like super messed up in the head and is like paranoid and everything. And it's got this weird creepy vibe. I loved the first half of it. But then I was expecting like a weird sinister twist or something. And the second half was very lacking for me. I think that it just kind of petered out instead of going out with a bang, which I feel like it should have. I feel like one of the kids should have just murdered the shit out of everyone. I would have been happy with that. That did not happen. Spoiler. It didn't happen. I gave it 3 stars. I think the first half would have been a 5-star, but the last half was like 1 star, so it just kind of met in the middle.
The next thing I read in April is The Chrysalids by John Wyndham. I originally decided to read this book because Sue at the restricted section drew it out of her April TBR jar. She didn't actually read it. I did, though, but I'm not holding it against her or anything like that. Anyway, I'll try not to spoil it, but this is a story, post-apocalyptia again, but it's in essentially a region, a farming region that is very Orthodox Christian, and there is so much radiation and mutation and things like that that there has to be, this community is survived by essentially culling anything with a mutation. Oh. And that's animals, plants, humans, and you know, obviously there's a religious element to it. And so it's this boy essentially finding out that he is not normal.
Oh.
And he's essentially he's the son of, like, the preacher. And, yeah. And it was very interesting from that perspective. And when I actually read this half and half, the physical copy here, and audiobook, the other half, and I wish I had stuck with just reading it on the physical form, because I kind of lost interest when I switched to audiobook, mm-hmm. and the ending didn't have much satisfaction in it.
I feel like we both stopped to burp at the same time.
The ending didn't have much satisfaction to it. I gave it 3 stars, though, because it did keep my interest the whole way through. But if I'm recommending John Wyndham, read Day of the Triffids.
The next thing I picked up was book 4 in the Cut and Run series. This is Divide and Conquer. And this one was freaking amazing. This was the first 5-star read out of the series. And I had so many feelings. I can't even begin to describe how amazing this book was.
Are you gonna be okay?
I don't know if I... That dancing scene was the sweetest thing I've ever read in my entire life.
You should mark it, and I'll jump right to that.
I feel like I need to. But you can't, though. You can't just jump in. You don't know the characters. You don't know their backstory. All the explosions they've been through.
All the wounds they've nursed each other through.
There's a lot of backstory, okay?
Okay. All right. Yeah, a lot of character depth.
There is.
Well, like you were saying, Fish and Chips developed all the character depth, right?
Well, it started to. They're obviously, they're still working on it.
Okay, that. It's a work in progress.
It's a 9-book series with a spin-off trilogy.
Makes sense. All right, the next thing I read was The Player of Games by Ian M. Banks. This is the second in the Culture series. Consider Flavus is the first. I talk about that one all the time. I enjoyed this one. I still like Consider Flavus better. But this one is about a society where a game controls essentially who is the emperor of this planet, or planet's society. Anyway, this guy from the culture who is good at playing games, he decides he's going to play it just because he loves a challenge of any kind of game and he's good at them. And there's intrigue that goes along with that because it ties into just that this game is everything to this society of people. And very, very, very fun. Keeps you on edge pretty much the whole way through. And I love the utopian aspects of the culture society in these books. It's not something I hear about too often. I don't read modern science fiction because I'm trying to read this list, but it's not something you hear of as a very common reoccurring theme. So.
I haven't read a lot of science fiction, but I totally understand, like, most of the science fiction, like the future worlds that I read about are usually, there's so much conflict and so much fighting that you don't actually see utopian societies often.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. That sounds very, so fascinating.
Very interesting. Yeah. Of course, they're surrounded by non-utopian societies where there's conflict there. Sure. That's where they get it from. Yeah.
The next thing I read was Fangirl by Rainbow Rowell. I listened to this on audiobook, And this is one I've been putting off for a really long time because I love Carry On so much. And this is the book that came right before Carry On. And this is about the character who wrote Carry On, the fan fiction. And I thought it was going to be, I don't know. I thought it was going to make me like Carry On a lot less. But this was actually wonderful. And I loved Kath and how nerdy and awkward she was. And she's a freshman in college, and she's just trying to deal with normal life, and she's obsessed with this fandom, and she writes fan fiction, and then she starts dating this boy, and their relationship is so weird, but it just totally works, because she's an awkward little nerd, and he's like this very social, outgoing person, and they mesh well together.
That's cute.
It's adorable. I'm really glad I read Carry On first. Otherwise, I would totally be pissed, like everyone else, about these huge sections of fan fiction that are just thrown in there randomly without any context. So you get a little snippet of characters doing things, and you're like, don't know who this character is. Don't know this thing that they're doing. There's no context whatsoever. But since I've already read like 600 page long book that is Carry On, I kind of understand. I gave this 5 stars. I thought it was wonderful.
Awesome. The last thing I read in April is The Three Stigmata of Palmer Eldritch, and this is by Philip K. Dick. This is actually probably the most understandable story of that I've read by Philip K. Dick, next to Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? That one was pretty straightforward. This one is about illegal drugs that kind of put people in these hallucinatory worlds. There's two different versions of it. There's two corporations that are, in the background behind these two competing drugs, and then corporate espionage going in with all the different characters, things like that. And then this twist at the end that just is just... Classic Dick, right? Nice.
Hashtag classic Dick.
Yeah. That should be a thing.
We're making it a thing.
Anyway, I gave this one... What did I give this one? I'm going to say 4 stars because... Yeah, well, I apparently rated it 3 stars, but I'm going to give it 4 stars because it's been marinating for a bit.
Nice.
I enjoyed that one a lot. I'd say it could be a beginner book if you're into, if you want to try out Philip K. Dick, but it is a bit dry until you get to the more end points. So, yeah. Maybe you should just start with Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, if you're going
to. I feel like I used to own that book, and then I never read it.
I've had a copy of it since we've been together.
I don't know. Maybe you just, yeah. I don't know. Okay, I read Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them by Newt Scamander, a.k.a. J.K. Rowling. not the screenplay, but the book that was published, way before, where it's just alphabetically talking about the Fantastic Beasts in the Harry Potter world. And I thought it was fun, but it needed way more illustrations. It only had one illustration every couple of pages, and I thought that was ridiculous. I did give it 4 stars. I did learn something about the Harry Potter universe, and as someone who grew up with Harry, that's really rare. And so, boom. And then the last thing I read was Us by Serena Bowen and Elle Kennedy, and this is the sequel that didn't need to happen, but was appreciated. This is carrying on from Him, and Wes and Jamie are adorable, but I always forget how smutty these books are. It's just the first 50 pages of this was nothing but smut. I was like, oh, right. Yeah, no, I forgot about that. I remember. I don't know. I think the characters are adorable, but this story was a lot different than the first one. A lot of this revolved around one of the characters having like a complete mental breakdown. Like, they move from California to like a northern part of Canada and they get no sunlight anymore and they go into a huge depressive funk. And this might be a spoiler, but like the thing that brings him out of the funk is his boyfriend proposes to him and he's like, oh my God, of course, I love you so much. And then everything's happy and wonderful. It's like, that doesn't make sense.
Not really how real life works.
Nope. A proposal is not gonna fix your life. But I did enjoy it. I gave it 4 stars. And this the last one in that series, but there's a spin-off series where you get to see bits and pieces of those characters' lives afterwards, after this series ends. So I think I'll pick up the spin-off.
Gabby at Gabby Read said she picked it up just to
She
get
yeah, she didn't like
more of
it.
a view of, yeah, and
Yeah.
there wasn't enough of those guys.
Right. No, but I actually really liked the character that the spin-off is going to be about. Like, we're introduced to him in this, and I thought he was hilarious. He reminds me of one of your old friends, Chad.
Oh, Chad.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good old Chad.
Yeah. So that was what we have read
Our wrap up
recently.
for April. Let us know what you read. Give us some comments on what we read. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do. And other than that, we'll see you next time. Take care, everyone.
Bye.